Hill?
An hour, so 5:45.
Okay. We can probably have quite a few questions and answers in that because this is a short psalm.
Does anybody need the handout?
I'll explain the nature of the handout. It's designed to go front and back so that it would fit in a Bible or fit in a bulletin, because the church that I was speaking at when I prepared this in this form liked all notes to go into the bulletin. Let's pray. Father, we do thank you for your word. We thank you for the fact that we can rely upon you to do what you have always done. The fact that we do not always see it, or believers that we are ministering do not see you at work, means that we need to understand your word. Help us to understand it, that we can perceive how it is that you actually intervene within history. Cause us to see the things around us from a vertical perspective with you in mind. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. I have often given this as a 4th of July message. The title of the message is If the Foundations Are Destroyed. When we look at our nation, things that we would have taken for granted only a few years ago are under assault. And it becomes very easy to become discouraged, and so many people have lost all hope because of how things are falling apart within our nation. David experienced something very similar. The background that I would see for this psalm is the rebellion of Absalom. Now, in the Hebrew Bible, the superscriptions for the Psalms are part of verse 1. So when people read the Psalms in English, they often do not realize that the superscription, the words that are above verse 1, are actually verse 1 in the Hebrew. So let's start with the real verse 1 of Psalm 11. To the chief musician, a psalm of David. David is the author, and the historical circumstance that gave rise to this psalm, I would argue, is the rebellion of Absalom. So David found himself with his son having taken over the city of Jerusalem, and he had a couple of options. He could have remained in the city and fought, but that would have resulted in many civilian casualties. Many people who were innocent would have been killed in the fighting if it had occurred within the city. David's advisors say you don't know who you can trust. And when you read the pertinent passages in the Old Testament, you find that certain people made out as though they were David's friends, and then after a while they turned on him. And his advisors apparently have made note of that. So the question becomes, should David stay in Jerusalem or should he leave Jerusalem? And if he were to leave Jerusalem, what would be the motivation for him leaving? Now, we do know that he left, and we're told that he left in order to protect the populace, that people would not unnecessarily be exposed to the fighting, that the people who were not part of the rebellion would not suffer as much. But David's advisors say, you can't trust God. God won't protect you. You need to leave. So as we look at this psalm, We have a question that comes up as we look at near the bottom of page one of the notes. David trusts God, so he rejects his advisor's plea for him to flee. That's verse 1b. It would be verse 1 in the English. In the Lord, I put my trust. How can y'all, it is plural, how can y'all say to my soul, flee as a bird to your mountain? David's saying, the very fact that I have trusted in the Lord makes it so that I regard your advice for me to flee in fear, to be absolutely ridiculous. So far, so good. The text is very clear up to this point, but already I see a problem as I look at the end of verse 1. You notice that little quotation mark inside the question mark. I am going to argue that it does not belong there. It should instead move to the end of verse 3. And let me show you why it is going to need to move somewhere. This is not a logical place for it. Let's look at verse 1 in our English. In the Lord I put my trust. How can you say to my soul, flee as a bird to your mountain? David is saying, I reject your advice. How can you tell me to flee in fear like a bird fluttering off to Masada? The mountain to which he would be going would be Masada. That is the fortress where he would be going for protection. But look at verse 2. Does verse 2 look like David speaking, or does verse 2 look like the advisors whose advice David is rejecting? For look, the wicked bend their bow. They make ready their arrow on the string, that they may shoot secretly at the upright in heart. If the foundations are destroyed, what can the righteous do? Does that sound like David giving a reason to reject their advice? No. It's part of their advice. They're telling him why he should leave, in their opinion. So the quotation goes all the way to the end of verse 3. But that's not the only translation problem we have in this section. Now, what he's saying here, though, as we look at verse 2, he says, the wicked bend their bow, and literally the Hebrew says that they tread it. They step on their bow in order to stretch the string so that the bow is ready to shoot an arrow. But this is not a frontal warfare. This is a sneak attack. Because look at what he says. They make ready their arrow on the string, that they may shoot secretly at the upright in heart. David may here be hearing warnings that maybe someone's planning to assassinate him. It's also possible that it's figuratively speaking about that people may do things to undermine David's stability as king. After all, Absalom has taken over the palace, and there are a number of former advisors of David that have already abandoned him and have gone to advise Absalom. I'm going to digress just for a moment. When we read in Genesis chapter 9 about the rainbow being given as a sign of the Noahic covenant, do you know why God would choose a rainbow for that peace treaty? Any idea why he would choose a rainbow to symbolize the peace treaty, not to ever flood the world in its entirety ever again? Okay, it's keshet. It's exactly the same word that is used for bow as in bow and arrow. But when the warrior hangs his bow on the wall and it's hanging this way, he's at peace. It's when he takes the bow off the wall and treads it so that he can get the string onto it that he's at war. And God is at peace, and he reminds us that he's at peace by having a bow that's hanging up on the wall. Just a little side note on that. Now, in verse 3, if the foundations are destroyed, that certainly sounds like 2015 United States of America. You can imagine how things were absolute chaos because it had progressed beyond the point of things being bad. I mean, we see things being bad, and we see police officers being shot at. We see recruiting stations. We see assassinations that happen on military bases. We see all kinds of things that are just utterly despicable. And we don't see the will to deal with the things appropriately. We see the government looking the other way, and nothing makes sense as to what the government's response is to things. Political correctness is going to kill us all. I mean, it's just the most wild sort of thing that we see going on. But it was even worse here in David's day. Because not only were things chaotic, but David is no longer on the throne. The government has been taken over. Absalom is in power. And David doesn't know who his friends are or who his enemies are. But the last part of verse 3 has two problems in the translation. It is a very bad translation of the last part of it. And I have some notes on that on page 2 of the notes. The verb is a Hebrew perfect. Perfect is a past tense. They have rendered it in the New King James as can. What can the righteous in the future do? They've treated it as though it's a future tense, as though it were an imperfect. But that's not the form that's used here. We have some translations that have gotten this correct. And the first point I'm going to notice is that these translations have understood that it is a past tense. The Geneva Bible of 1599 reads, "What hath the righteous done?" Brenton of 1851 reads, "What has the righteous done?" Young's literal translation of 1898 says, "The righteous, what hath he done?" A Catholic Bible, the Douay Rheims, reads, "What has the just man done?" And the Jewish Publication Society, JPS of 1917, reads, "What hath the righteous wrought?" So notice, each one of them have rendered it as a past tense. But that's not all. Each one of these has also signaled that they understand that it is singular. And you may not catch that right off the bat, but if I say, "He has done," the form "has" goes with a third person singular form. In other words, like a he or a she or an it. He has done. But if I want to talk about plural and I say they, I wouldn't say they has done. I would say they have done. Notice each one of these forms makes it clear that they understand that the word righteous is a singular. I bet that a lot of us, when we read this, thought, what can the righteous people do? Or what have the righteous people done? But it's a singular. What has he done? What has the righteous one done? So notice, hath or has appears in each of those translations. Each is singular.
So in the original, it's singular?
It is singular. But I would argue that there is one remaining thing, though, that is wrong in each of these translations. None of them have capitalized the word righteous. What David's advisors are saying is, God has let everything fall apart. What has he done? He's left you stranded. He won't protect you. You need to flee. Because God won't protect you. With advisors like that, it's time for David to teach them. And that's what he did initially. But you remember, he also gave this to the chief choir director. So the chief choir director could teach the nation as they would sing this psalm. So, the concept here is that the advisors are saying God has done nothing. He's allowed all of this, these terrible things to happen. He doesn't care for you, and he's not going to protect you. He's allowed everything to go to pieces, and you're on your own. We better flee. David has his work cut out for him because his advisors have lost their minds. They do not understand that God is in control. So they're saying, flee, since the righteous God has done nothing to protect you or us. And David says, how can you advise me this? How? This is crazy. And so what he goes on to do in the final sections of this passage is to say that God is doing what he has always done. He's still in control. And David doesn't need to flee in fear. David does leave the city, but he doesn't leave it for the reason his advisors suggest. He does so so that the populace will not be decimated in a civil war. He is willing to accept what it is that they say should be done, but he is not willing to accept their reason for why they think it should be done. So, as we look at verses 4 through 7, he says that God is in control. The Lord is in his holy temple. The Lord's throne is in heaven. His eyes behold, his eyelids test the sons of men. God is there supervising humanity in the way that he always has. And in particular, this verse is looking at God's supervision over all of humanity. But now as we go to verse 5, things change a little bit. The Lord tests the righteous. Now there's a difference between how Ford Motor Company tests Ford Motor cars on their proving ground and how they test Chrysler cars. And the same is true for Chrysler. When Chrysler is testing a Ford product, they test it differently than they test Chrysler products. How so? They run them through the same obstacle course, but they have isolated certain things that they say, this is a weakness in the competitive car, and it won't do quite as well through this obstacle course. So Ford designs a pretty tough test that the Ford comes out just a little better than anybody else's car. And Chrysler designs just a little different test, and the strong points of the Chrysler come through, and Yeah, they can say, wow, look at our car. It came through, but this other car didn't. There's a difference between how God tests the righteous, how he tests believers, and how he deals with unbelievers. Because God, as we know from 1 Corinthians 10, will not allow us to be tested or tempted beyond what we are able. But he will provide with the testing or temptation a way of escape that we may be able to endure it. David and those of his advisors who are believers are being tested by God to see, will they depend upon him or will they not? And David looks at his advisors and he says, you're not depending on God. I've put my trust in him. I know that whatever he allows to come into my life is appropriate. But his advisors say, God has lost control. God isn't able to deal with this anymore. You know, I run into a lot of Christians now during 2015 that have given up and say, it's so bad, I wish I weren't alive now. But this is a time where we have a special opportunity. We have the opportunity to trust God, not to put us through a circumstance that we are not able to bear with his strength that he supplies. And David is telling his advisors that that was the case in David's day. And so the Lord tests the righteous, but the wicked and the one who loves violence. Funny thing about that word violence, it's Hamas. Now, Hamas there in the Middle East, that's an acronym. It's like IRS. Yeah, it's not letters for a word, it's letters that stand for words. It's an acronym. And so the organization, the terrorist organization, Hamas, that's an acronym. But the word for violence, or one word for violence in Hebrew, is Hamas. So every time I run into the word Hamas, I think about that association. But God says he hates those people. He's opposed to them. He's going to throw obstacles in their way, and they are not ultimately going to stand. Even if they are believers, they will not stand. If they're believers, it doesn't mean he takes away their eternal life, but it does mean no reward, and it means temporal discipline. It means all sorts of things in their lives. And if they are opposed to what God's plan is, their plans will come to naught. So David says, upon the wicked he will rain coals, fire and brimstone and a burning wind shall be the portion of their cup. He is using imagery of the destruction of Sodom and Gomorrah. He says, God has plans for the wicked in time. He, of course, has plans for unbelievers, and he has plans for rebellious believers in eternity as well. But in time is what David is talking about. David is saying, I don't need to flee like a bird, acting as though God has done nothing, because he said, I know God is in control. And let's think about it. How long did Absalom stay on the throne? Not very long. Then he had this nice, pretty long hair, and he got himself caught in a tree as he was riding his horse. And then one of David's generals came along and did him in. And so David was saying, I don't know exactly how all this is going to work out, but he said, I know who's in control. And David doesn't have to act in panic. He trusts in the Lord. Now he explains why God deals differently with the righteous, with believers, especially with believers who are using the word in their lives, as opposed to wicked people, whether believers or unbelievers. For the Lord is righteous. He loves righteousness. His countenance beholds the upright.
Are believers capable of being wicked?
Absolutely. And so David is here able to encourage his advisors to turn their eyes back on God. They had allowed the circumstances of their lives to turn their eyes away from him and to become focused upon how terrible things were instead of seeing God still in control. It's easy for us to become sidetracked. We spend all of our time living our lives at the horizontal plane, and we quickly forget about the vertical plane and that God is in control. And David is here giving a reminder to his advisors that we ought to take to heart as well. This is very much in keeping with what we discussed there in the book of Romans. We can take questions and then I can do another short psalm. Yes?
You know, the backdrop of David is that when he committed adultery with Bathsheba, part of his penal servitude, to use the expression from the previous hour, he was given a certain amount of discipline that was even named off that some of the circumstances
right.
that happened here would indeed happen. So if you could talk about that for a second, for the fact that David, even with this discipline that was told him, still rose up from that to deal with it in this way.
Yes, David had been given underlying promises. God would establish a dynasty. God would do certain protections and accomplish certain things through David. And God had not forgotten the promises that he made to this man who was after his own heart, even though David had significant failings. David would be a good illustration, an Old Testament illustration of someone who would be regarded highly in the Romans 8 context, which did not mean a person without failing. And David did face consequences. God dealt with him. But David was able to accept the consequences, the discipline, the penal servitude that he received, and not lose sight of the overarching promises that God had made to him. And that's an important thing to remember. You know, we may suffer this and that as a result of our own failings, whether we view it as discipline or whether it's just the natural consequences for actions, which I believe is a form of God's wrath. But at the same time, we have to always keep in mind that God, as he makes promises, is faithful to those promises. And it's possible to become distracted by things and lose sight of the bigger picture. We still have everlasting life, and God has designed things for our good and has designed ways of recovering at times when we do fail. And it's very easy for us to lose sight of the bigger picture.
Kick ourselves, to use that expression, for not having maybe spoken out when we could have or should have on this subject or that subject or this whatever. So now we go, oh boy, now we're getting the consequences of our
sure.
not speaking up or whatever. But then at the end of that psalm, when it says, the Lord is righteous, he loves righteousness, his mm-hmm. countenance beholds the upright, does it not place the emphasis
yes.
on, if we are upright and do what is right right now in light of your first message, we really have
God's countenance looking upon us who are willing to take the hits. We don't know, we don't have the promises that God's going to correct things, but at least we have the promise that he's upholding and looking at the upright, and he can do a lot of good things.
Well, let me look at a couple of illustrations of this that Steve is asking. Let's turn to John 4. Now, Jesus was training disciples, right? And so they were supposed to be sharing the message of life. That's the reason that he's preparing them. And when they went into the village of Sychar in John chapter 4, we're told that they went into town in order to buy food. And guess what they came back with? Food. Yeah, it's pretty evident that they had gone off into town in order to buy food, and lo and behold, they came back and bought food. So look at verse 8 of John 4. Jesus is having the conversation with the Samaritan woman, but he's there with her alone, because verse 8 says, "For his disciples had gone into the city to buy food." Well, Jesus reaches the punchline with the Samaritan woman, because he had said, if you knew the gift of God and who it is that says to you, give me a drink, you would have asked and he would have given you living water. She comes to terms first with the eternality of the gift that he's offering. And then in verse 25, the woman said to him, I know that Messiah is coming, who is called Christ. When he comes, he will tell us all things. She's saying, you've told me everything. Hint, hint. Could you possibly be the Christ? So his answer to her was, I who speak to you am. Yes, I am the Christ. Meanwhile, back at the ranch, verse 27, and at this point his disciples came and they marveled that he talked with a woman. Yet no one said, what do you seek, or why are you talking with her? So his disciples returned from buying food. Now look at what the woman does. The woman then left her water pot, went away into the city, and said to the men, come see a man who told me all the things I ever did. Could this be the Christ? So what does she do? She came out to get water, and what does she do? She leaves her water pot. The disciples went into town to buy food, and they came back with food. Sure enough. In verse 31. In the meantime, his disciples urged him, saying, Rabbi, eat. Peter's saying, I'm hungry. Let's say grace and let's eat. Jesus, come on, let's eat. And he said, I have food to eat of which you do not know. Therefore, his disciples said to one another, has anyone brought him anything to eat? Come on, fess up. Who brought him some food? Why isn't he hungry? We're hungry. Come on, Jesus, start eating. And what does Jesus say to them? Verse 34, my food is to do the will of him who sent me and to finish his work. Do you not say there are still 4 months and then comes the harvest? Behold, I say, lift up your eyes and look at the fields. They are already white for harvest. And he who reaps receives wages and gathers fruit for eternal life, that both he who sows and he who reaps may rejoice together. For in this the saying is true, one sows and another reaps. I sent you to reap. Jesus said, go into town, buy some food. But he was hoping they'd come back with people. The town is ripe for harvest. All it takes is this woman walking into town and saying, there's a man and he told me everything I ever did. Could he possibly be the Christ? And droves of people come out with her to see Jesus. He's saying, I sent you to reap. I said, go buy some food. But when you were bartering with those people, did you tell them who you had along with you? Did you try to figure out if they might be interested in finding out about the Christ? I bet you guys didn't even know that this town had all kinds of people that were just, wow, excited when they run into the message. He said, all you did was ask, how much are those potatoes? And that's where their focus was. They were not even noticing. They didn't even test the waters to see if maybe people might be interested in the truth they had. And the woman walks into town without her water pot, which was the reason that she came out. She came out to get water. And now she says, I've got something more important to do than bring water back home. And the disciples that Jesus was sending into town so that they would come back with some people only came back with food. They blew it. But look at what Jesus says. Verse 38. I sent you to reap that for which you have not labored. Others have labored and you have entered into their labors. Entering into someone else's labors gives a possibility of reward. He said, you didn't reap. You didn't sow. I sowed and the woman sowed. Okay, you blew that opportunity. But you can help in reaping. They blew it, but Jesus didn't say, okay, forget it. I think I ought to start looking for Samaritans to be my disciples. Okay, let's look at another passage where we see something very similar, and I'm going to translate it a little differently than you've ever heard it translated. Let's go to Matthew 16. In Matthew 16, Jesus speaks in verse 13, and if you have a King James or a New King James, your translation will be correct. If you have a New American Standard or some other versions, the word I is going to be missing. It's an important little clarification, especially as one is talking to scholars, but I find it very helpful. When Jesus came into the region of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, saying, who do men say that I, the Son of Man, am? Jesus had often called himself Son of Man, but you won't find him defining what he means by the term. And that has puzzled scholars. Because some say, he's just a son of Adam. That's just a way of saying, I'm human. And some have looked at the fact that Ezekiel is called by God in the book of Ezekiel about 90 times, Son of Man. So some have thought that it refers to being a prophet. And then there's Daniel 7, 13 and 14, and the Son of Man that will come, the Messiah, who will win the great victory and establish the millennial kingdom. So scholars have wondered, what does Jesus mean when he calls himself Son of Man? And lo and behold, Jesus says, what do people think that I mean when I call myself Son of Man? So notice the question there in verse 13. Who do men say that I, the Son of Man, am? And what he's saying is, okay, what do people think that I mean? Why do they think that I call myself Son of Man? So they said, some say John the Baptist. That's what Herod Antipas said. Remember, he said, I put John the Baptist to death. And here he is, and he's come back, and he's here to haunt me. Uh-oh. Guilty conscience. So that was Herod the Great, or Herod Antipas's answer. Some say Elijah, or one of the prophets. That's thinking like the fact that Ezekiel was called Son of Man 90 or so times. And others say Jeremiah, or one of the prophets. But he said to them, who do y'all say that I am? You guys, you disciples, what do you think that I mean? Jesus has not defined this up to this point. And Jesus is asking them, have you figured out what I mean? Why do I call myself Son of Man? And Peter answered and said, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. And I would see this as he understands, I'm looking at you, right here, a man, but you're Daniel, Son of Man, who is God. Let me show you that Daniel, Son of Man, is God. Let me show you. Let's go to Daniel chapter 7. So he's saying, I'm looking at you and you're man, but I know you're God. Daniel chapter 7. I was watching in the night visions, and behold, Chvaranosh, one like a son of man. There is no the there. Behold, one like son of man, coming with the clouds of heaven. Clouds of heaven in a vision regularly stand for God. And he's coming with the clouds. Cloud rider is always, in Middle Eastern imagery, God. He came to the Ancient of Days. David's saying, or Daniel is saying, this is getting complicated. God came to God. And he's saying, I don't quite know what to do with this. I know it's a vision from God, so I know it's true, but God, one like a son of man, cloud rider, came to God, the Ancient of Days. And they brought him near before him. And previous context has described the throne room, the heavenly throne room of the Ancient of Days, God. Then to him was given dominion and glory and a kingdom, that all peoples, nations, and languages should palach him. And the word palach is translated serve, but every time it's used in Daniel, every time it's used in Ezra, in the Aramaic sections of those books, and every time that I've been able to track it down in Northwest Semitic, it always refers to worship-type service. So the one like the Son of Man is going to be worshipped forever. His dominion is an everlasting dominion. He's not only living forever, he's reigning forever. And his kingdom will not pass away. And his kingdom, the one which shall not be destroyed. This is God. And Daniel is giving, or being given, a glimpse into there are two members of the Trinity. And can you imagine him thinking, you know, I'm a nice Jewish guy who knows that there's only one God. And he's saying, I don't get it. But now look at verse 15. In Daniel chapter 7. I, Daniel, was grieved in my spirit within my body, and the visions of my head troubled me. He says, I don't get this. And yet, when we compare, let me do an illustration here. The book of Daniel, Daniel chapters 1 up through 2, 3, and chapters 8 through 12 are all written in Hebrew. Chapter 2, verse 4 through the end of chapter 7 is all written in Aramaic. And I believe that there's a reason for that. The Hebrew sections of the book look at mainly at future times through Jewish eyes. And chapters 2 through 7 look at the same events, but through Gentile eyes. Very, very interesting thing, the way that it's done. But besides that, there's another interesting thing. When you look at Daniel, almost every chapter of Daniel has a date stamp saying, this vision happened in such and such a year of such and such a king, so we can date it. And that's really important because chapters 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and 7 are not in chronological order. And the proof of that is in Daniel chapter 5, which has a date stamp. Belshazzar, the last king of the Babylonians, got killed. And then in Daniel chapter 6, he's alive and well. And it's not a cartoon. It is that instead, the chapters are not put in chronological order. And that's the reason that almost all of the chapters in Daniel have date stamps, because it's not arranged chronologically. So then you say, well, how is it arranged? God, yes, good question. It is arranged in what is called a chiasm. Chapter 2 talks about Nebuchadnezzar's great statue. Remember the one with the head of gold and then the feet of mixed iron and clay? Well, chapter 7 talks about the four bestial kingdoms, the four beasts, including the fourth one who's a monster. And then it talks about the kingdom of the one like the Son of Man. Lo and behold, they're talking about the same thing, but different imagery. So chapter 2 corresponds to chapter 7. Then we have chapter 3 and chapter 6. Fiery furnace and the lion's den. They're talking about a similar idea. It had different numbers of characters and so forth, but the point that's being made is very similar. And chapter 4, you have the humiliation of Nebuchadnezzar, where he ends up eating grass like a beast and has the dew on his back during his 10 years of insanity. That is well documented. And then chapter 5, you have the humiliation of Belshazzar with the handwriting on the wall saying, bye-bye, and he dies. And the Babylonians are overthrown by Media Persia. So it's arranged at a chiasm. 2 corresponds to 7, 3 corresponds to 6, 4 corresponds to 5. And so Daniel put it in that kind of an arrangement, so that's why he didn't put them in chronological order. And since he didn't put them in chronological order, there's a date stamp on most of those chapters. So, what we have, the upshot of that is, many, 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 many years before, Daniel had interpreted for Nebuchadnezzar a statue with a head of gold and the feet of clay mixed with iron. Almost nothing, very, very little, in chapter 7 is totally new. He already knew about the things that were going to happen. And yet he's greatly troubled. My analysis as to why he's troubled is, God came to God, and God gave God a kingdom, dominion, and authority, and the new God was worshiped forever. He's saying, I don't get it. I thought there was only one God. Well, there is only one God. But even though there's one God, the one God exists in three persons. And Daniel was perplexed. He's saying, I don't get it. I know it's true, but I don't get it. It bothered him. Well, Peter, as we go back to Matthew chapter 16, yes?
I'm sorry. So did they teach the Trinity? I mean, did they have a Genesis?
Genesis gives hints at it, but they didn't know what to do with it.
So they didn't have a clear concept of what to do now?
Right, they didn't have the clear concept. It was hinted at in the Old Testament. But the New Testament clearly reveals the overall picture into which it goes. So we can look back at the Old Testament and we can say, okay, we get it. But they were puzzling over it. Peter tells us in 2 Peter that the prophets wrote about things that they often didn't understand, and they knew they didn't understand. So as we return to Matthew 16, verse 16, Simon Peter answered and said, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God. You are here. I see you. You're human. But you're Daniel's son of man. You're that one that's going to rule that's God. You're the one that deserves worship and is going to be worshiped forever." He's saying, you're the God man. And he's saying a lot right here. Now, this isn't when Peter became a believer. He became a believer way back in John chapter 1. But he's saying here, I know what you mean when you talk about yourself being son of man. You're talking about yourself as being God. It's a title of deity. You're the one who's going to be worshipped forever. So then in verse 17, Jesus answered and said to him, "Blessed are you, Simon Bar-Jonah." Bar in Aramaic means son of. And Jonah, so the name of Simon Peter's father was Jonah. So he's saying, Simon, son of Jonah. And we find that also when you look in John chapter 1. He's there called Simon, son of Jonah. "For flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father who is in heaven." Now, as we saw, I said this in a different message, so I'm getting all my messages mixed up. I've spoken 8 times since last Monday. But what we have is, Jesus regularly gives credit that his teaching originated from the Father. And so I believe that Jesus is saying, the Father revealed this to you through my teaching you. So it's along the line of, I spoke about that this morning instead of this afternoon. So I'm getting passages that I spoke on recently mixed in here. So, sorry. So, with that, we'd say Peter's doing really well. You know, Peter's getting A+ on this test. But now let's just drop down a little bit. Verse 21. "From that time, Jesus began to show his disciples that he must go to Jerusalem and suffer many things from the elders and chief priests and scribes and be killed and be raised on the third day. Then Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him, saying, 'Far be it from you, Lord, for this shall not happen to you.'" Peter's not doing so well anymore. Peter was really getting it, but now he's not. And then we've got that problematic statement, "Get behind me, Satan." Well, they got the word "me" right. I think they missed every other word. Satan just is an ordinary Hebrew word that means adversary. And I would take it that he's just calling Peter adversary. Don't think he's calling him Satan. I think that he's just saying, you're opposed to me. And the "get behind me" gives the impression of, I don't ever, ever want to see you. Get out of here, get gone. You know, I mean, we get the impression. Just get out of here. It's a wrong impression. The word translated "behind" is opiso. And our impression when we read this is, get out of here. Now let me just ask this. If you've got an adversary, do you want your adversary right there behind your back? That is not where you want him. Why is he telling Peter, go there? We get a clue if we stop treating paragraph marks as being absolute breaks. But first of all, he says, you are an offense to me, for you are not mindful of the things of God, but the things of men. You are opposing me because you are listening to people's thoughts. You're not listening to God's thoughts. And what I'm going to suggest is he's saying you're trying to lead instead of follow. So now, in verse 24, then Jesus said to his disciples, not just to Peter, he said it to all of them, if anyone wishes to come, opiso me. It's that same word that was translated behind. If anyone wants to come after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross, and follow me. Peter, as long as you're trying to lead me, you're opposing me. If you become a disciple again and you start following me, come on, Peter, get back here. Come on, get back here. Come on, get behind me. Start following me. Hey, the rest of you disciples, come on. Come on, you get behind me. If you want to come after me, come on, get behind me. Start following. He said, stop trying to lead. Come behind me. It's not where you put your adversary. He's wanting Peter to become a follower and stop being an adversary. So notice, Peter scored wonderfully, then Peter blew it, and Jesus gives him an opportunity, along with the rest of the disciples. Okay, come on, there's a road here. And this road, if you follow me, it leads in a very good direction, but you got to stop trying to lead me because you're trying to lead me the wrong way. If you follow, you'll get there the right way because I'm going the right way and you'll follow me there. Whole different picture on this passage, isn't it? Yes?
Is it fair to say that just human nature, the way it is, that perhaps the disciples had been discussing this in previous times, and maybe Jesus made a statement similar to that, and Peter just happened to speak what everybody else perhaps had known?
Well, yes, I've...
as the spokesman, and also because just the fact that he talked to the whole group of disciples after that, it's almost like he took a little bit of the heat off of Peter at that moment and said, I know what all the rest of you guys are saying. We don't know that for sure, but it certainly could have been a possibility, right?
Yeah, it's... Peter tended to be spokesman for the rest of them. And so, the following verse, he addresses all of them and may well be hinting that the rest of them were thinking what Peter said. So this gives illustrations that even at times when there's major failure, Christ isn't inclined to say, it's over, it's done with, can't do anything. I think there's another place we can illustrate Peter. Let's look at the Gospel of John. And this one we'll do real quick. In John chapter 10, Jesus told about the Good Shepherd. Now, please note that chapter 10, verse 1 does not say, after these things Jesus said. If you have red letter Bibles, where do your red letters begin? And I'll give you a hint. They don't begin at 10:1. Where does the red letters begin? Where does the quote begin? 9:41. So, in 9:41, Jesus said to them, Pharisees, that were accompanying him, Pharisees that had been connected with the excommunication of the formerly blind men. And there's a reason Jesus is really hard on them. We know from the parents of the blind man that the religious leaders of that synagogue had announced that if anyone confessed Jesus as the Christ, that that person would be excommunicated from the synagogue. That was premeditated. Well, lo and behold, we are also told that until the Pharisees interrogated the man's parents, they did not believe that he was the man who was born blind. They thought it was a shill who just looked like the one who had been born blind. But when they cross-examined the parents and the parents stood up to the cross-examination, they concluded, okay, well, yes, there really was a miracle. So lo and behold, they know that there was a miracle, that this blind man formerly was blind, now he sees, and Jesus is the one who healed him. And the blind man says, Jesus healed me, and they excommunicate him for telling the truth, and they know it's the truth. Wow, that's wicked shepherds. So, John 9:41, Jesus tells about the good shepherd as opposed to the evil shepherds of Ezekiel 34 to a group of people who excommunicated someone for telling the truth that they knew was the truth. Sounds like our court systems. Well, in this process, Jesus talks about evil shepherds, but he talks about another class of shepherd that he calls the hireling. The hireling is not someone who's trying to do in the sheep, but he's someone who looks the other way when the wicked Pharisees do in innocent sheep. I'll tell you something that's very interesting. The model of shepherding that Jesus has is he says that his sheep know his voice and they follow He says they will not follow a stranger because they do not know his voice, but they will run away from him. Now, when you think about most churches and how they rule people with legalism like the Pharisees did, they have the model of the dogs nipping at the heels of the sheep chasing the sheep, and the sheep are running away from them, and the shepherds are chasing after them, and they're driving them. But Jesus uses grace, and his sheep follow him. He's not saying that they can't be chased by legalists. He's saying they won't follow legalists. It's a little different. Now, when he describes the hireling, when he sees the wolf coming, he runs away. He says, I won't stand up to that Pharisee. I might get hurt. He runs away. Now you remember, well, let's go to John chapter 13 at the end. In John chapter 13, Jesus said that he was going away. And so in verse 36, Simon Peter said to him, Lord, where are you going? Jesus answered him, where I'm going, you cannot follow me now, but you shall follow me afterward. Peter said to him, Lord, why can I not follow you now? I will lay down my mortal life, my psuche, for you. Jesus answered him, will you lay down your psuche for my sake? Most assuredly, amen, amen, I say to you, the rooster shall not crow till you have denied me three times. And Peter was absolutely sure that Jesus was wrong. You know, he went and he sliced off the ear of that slave. He wasn't aiming at the guy's ear. Peter just didn't have very good aim. But he sliced off the ear of that slave. He was trying to put that guy to death. Do you think Peter expected to live out the night? There were all these armed soldiers around with weapons and torches and everything else. He was giving up his psuche for the Lord. He was sure that the Lord was wrong. And then what happens? Jesus says, if you want me, telling the people who are arresting him, let these men go. Even Peter, who drew blood, gets let loose. And Jesus puts the ear back on the slave. Well, then, later on, in John chapter 21, seven of the disciples have breakfast with Jesus on the shore of the Sea of Galilee. And lo and behold, after breakfast, Jesus starts talking with Peter. And he says, do you love me? And of course, we've got the bantering back and forth corresponding to the three times that Peter denied him. He gets three chances to affirm him. And Peter's thinking, oh, and he really got grieved the third time because he's saying, I'm a hireling. I'm out of here. He can't use me for ministry. But Peter wasn't listening really carefully because what did Jesus say three times? Feed my sheep, tend my lambs, feed my sheep. He's saying, do ministry. I'm trusting you to handle the sheep. He's not saying Peter's disqualified. He's saying, become involved in ministry. And then Jesus gave encouraging words to Peter. He told Peter how he was going to die. He encouraged him. No, you laugh. Let's look there. It was a great encouragement to Peter. Starting in verse 18 of John 21, most assuredly, amen, amen, I say to you, when you were younger, you girded yourself and you walked where you wished, but when you are old, you will stretch out your hands and another will gird you and carry you where you do not wish. This he spoke, signifying by what death? A crucifixion. He would glorify God. Can you imagine if Jesus had not said this, Peter would say, you know, I chickened out in front of a slave girl, someone who couldn't really hurt me. What am I going to do when it gets tough? Am I going to chicken out again? And Jesus says, you told me that you were willing to give your psuche, your mortal life for me. And Jesus told him, it's not time for you to do that yet. But now he says, you will die in service for me, and you will do so in a way that glorifies me. You will finish strong. You will do what you desired. You wanted to go out serving me wholeheartedly. You wanted to be a co-heir. You wanted to be someone who suffered with me. Peter, you will do that. You will not chicken out. You will not cave in. This is an encouragement to Peter. You know, normally we look at that and we say, wow, what a downer at the end of breakfast. But in the context of what Peter has said and done, Jesus is encouraging him. But we don't see that if we don't see how the whole book has set this up. Yes?
So in tying things together with what you said this morning about the Bema Seat of Christ, we have not Peter's, we do not have Peter's promise or
right.
thought of glorifying God in that way, but we have a promise if we suffer with Christ, we will rule and reign with him. So in a sense, when you departed from Psalm 11 and tying these things in, really, we have promises that even if we've done things that have resulted in failure,
yep.
that's where you're bringing all this, is that we
yep.
have the promises of the Bema Seat to draw us in that same way that Peter is in his failure. Really
right. I mean, Peter had a major failure there with the three denials. But Jesus is saying, I've got plans for you, and you are going to get exactly what you desire. So it's powerful, but we tend to just look at isolated verses. We don't tend to read whole books, and we don't tend to reread the book and reread it and reread it so that we understand the whole book. And I would urge you, read whole books and read it again and read it again, and you'll start to see connections within the book. And I have to say, this one about how this passage fits in, it was my son George that called it to my attention. He was working on editing some of my notes, and he was working in John 10 at the same time as he was working in John 21. He said, Dad, I think I know how this passage goes together. And I was all ears, because I didn't like the way I was putting it together. And so I would urge, just read a book over and over and over. Answer the questions from within the book as much as possible.
What version of the Bible do you use?
My Greek New Testament, much more than I use my New King James. I preach out of the New King James, but it's not where I live.
New King James is really close?
It's serviceable. There is no translation yet of the entire New Testament according to the majority text. I'm working on that. But
better if you get it from the Holy Spirit. Probably better if you get it from the Holy Spirit, I think. No, it's not that it's not useful, but if you had to search for it and you were a student of the Word, God honors that too.
Well, yeah. See, the issue is that translations are generally based on either the Textus Receptus, which is reasonably close to the majority text, or they are based on the Egyptian manuscripts, which are quite a bit further. But there is no translation of the whole New Testament from this Greek text.
Could you explain the majority side of things, John? The majority text and where that came from and how that plays into what that significant Greek text talks about?
Well, there are a large body of manuscripts that are very much like each other. They tend to be dismissed by many scholars as not important. And the reason that they tend to be dismissed is that the surviving manuscripts of this family are not early. And you have undoubtedly heard the text critical dictum that older is better. And I would agree with that, except there's a caveat that needs to be added. Older is better, all other things equal. And in this case, all other things are not equal. How might I illustrate that? Imagine that there is a champion dog, AKC registered, best of show, Westminster champion, overall companion dog. I mean, it just meets all the standards that the AKC has. I mean, it wins best of show. Well, you can imagine that they are going to be very careful in making sure that the progeny from this are from being mated with other dogs that are of the same caliber. So if you go down the genealogy, his offspring will end up having 50% of his DNA, and 50% will come from the mother. You go down another generation, it's going to be 25%, and 12.5%, and 6.25%, and so on and so forth. So the percentage of DNA that are coming from this champion ends up being less and less as you go down. But we can go down a whole bunch of generations, and if it was a German Shepherd, believe me, that offspring, many generations down, is going to look like a German Shepherd, isn't it? But now imagine that one of his offspring runs away. And if we were able to trace the family tree of the runaway, it doesn't take long, and it's not looking at all like a German shepherd. It starts looking a lot different. And so, if we go down this line, we can get way down here and it still looks like a German shepherd because it's still a German shepherd, and they would be careful that it was still a championship line. We go down this one, and if we only get down this far, does this have more of the champion's DNA? This one. But does this or this one look more like the champion? This one doesn't look at all like it, even though it has a lot more of the DNA. So when we talk about earlier is better, it's assuming that we have equally good copying. If the copying is sloppy, you don't have to go down very many levels and it starts looking a lot different. If you have good copying, you can go for a long way and it won't change as much. So we say older is better, all other things equal. But now how is it, why is it, that I would say that the Alexandrian, the Egyptian manuscripts, even though they're older, are sloppier than the majority manuscripts, even though they are later? It's because when you start looking at how similar are all the Alexandrian manuscripts to each other, they are very, 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 very different. You look at the majority family manuscripts, and they're far more similar. So that when I compare the two main theories within the majority family, there is one text that was written, that viewed certain manuscripts as the best within the majority family, and there was another text that regarded other manuscripts as the best. And for the moment, it doesn't really matter which one of those two editions is better. Guess how many differences they had in the entire New Testament? 300. In my car, I have a Nestle 27. That's the Nestle text that favors the Egyptian manuscripts. And they do a cataloging of their favorite 8 editions of editions that favored the Alexandrian text type. And they show 7,000 places where they disagree with each other. And what I would argue, when you look at manuscripts, the majority family, although the manuscripts are late that we have that are surviving, they are very much like each other, whether it's produced in Greece or in Turkey. We're able on a lot of manuscripts to say where it was produced, and we're able to say when it was produced. And the manuscripts, despite being produced in different places in different centuries, are very much like each other. And the Egyptian manuscripts, although they're early, seem to have very little quality control, and they are quite distinct from each other. Now, why is it that we have late manuscripts only for the majority family, and we only have early ones for the Alexandrian? Well, there's a reason that we don't have any late ones for the Alexandrian. The Muslims took over, and they didn't allow any more copying. That cut off a date, so there wouldn't be any late ones. But why is it that we have early ones for the Egyptian and we don't have early elsewhere? Egypt often goes for years without rain. It's low humidity. And low humidity conditions favor the preservation of manuscripts for a long, long time. But the areas where the majority family manuscripts are found, Our higher humidity, it rains more and you'll get mold and mildew and all those kinds of things. And the things just don't survive as long. So yes, Alexandrian or Egyptian we have earlier, but earlier is only better, all other things equal. Would I rather have this manuscript in the majority family or this one? Well, I obviously would rather have this one, but because of the circumstances of geography and history, we don't have them. But we can see so many manuscripts that show by their similarity to each other that there was a careful transmission. And it's the careful transmission that is the reason that I argue for the superiority of the majority family.
So when you are using the majority text, there has yet to be an entire New Testament based off of that.
Translated,
which would be the more or the most serviceable based
right.
on what you just said.
Yes. Now, if you have a better edition of the New King James, you will see in the New Testament markings or footnotes that will say N or say U. And they'll say M. And so what they're telling you is the NESL and UBS text versus the majority text. So they give notes to help you find some of the places where the King James, which followed the Textus Receptus, which was the only printed text that they had available to them, which wasn't always the best handling. It, unfortunately, it has about 1,900 places that it differs with the majority text. That's a lot less than the critical text that differs almost 8,000 times with the majority text.
And who's the publisher of your...
Well, Thomas Nelson was the publisher. It is available electronically through Libronics, but they have not kept it in print in a printed form.
Is there a reason? Too expensive? Or
not enough demand. They were able to make more money by not printing, but by just releasing it electronically.
John, what's the argument?
Sure. The main thing is age, that the older Alexandrian manuscripts are considerably older, and that they think that certain things were done for theological motivation. Let me show you. I'll give you an example. Look at Matthew chapter 24, verse 36. Matthew 24:36, in the majority text, and also in the Textus Receptus, this is a place where those two texts agree, against the Alexandrian or Egyptian manuscripts. I'll read it as it is here. But of that day and hour, no one knows, not even the angels of heaven, but only my Father only. Any of your texts read significantly different than that?
Nor
the Son. Bruce Metzger argues that the majority family manuscripts, or the majority family scribes, thought that it was saying something bad about Jesus, that Jesus didn't know when that day or hour was. And so the scribes thought that in order to protect Jesus, they should remove those words. Does that make sense? Well, I mean, you could imagine someone reading something and saying, okay, I think it's saying something derogatory about Jesus, so let's remove it. Okay, that would be a theoretical possibility. And most people believe that that is the legitimate answer there. But I'm going to point out the same scribes that copied Matthew, also copied Mark. Okay? Let's look at Mark 13:32. And I've looked at lots and lots and lots and lots of manuscripts, and I've looked at lots of apparatuses on this particular passage. And in Mark 13, 32, I only know of two manuscripts out of a whole bunch of manuscripts. I only know of two that omit that phrase. So there are lots of manuscripts that in Matthew don't have those words, and in Mark they do. Written by the same scribe. So in Mark 13, 32, let's see, I'm in chapter 12, so I get to 13. It reads, "But of that day and hour no one knows, not even the angels in heaven nor the Son, but only the Father." Well, it doesn't make sense to say that the scribe left it out in Matthew because he had a theological problem, and the same scribe put it in Mark and didn't have a theological problem. It is instead that Matthew's account lacked those words. When we often think of quote as word for word without the possibility of leaving some words out. But they couldn't always get whole quotes, because although I believe from where the Gospels tell us that Jesus, through the Holy Spirit, would bring to the recollection of the apostles the things that he said, I think that they had amazing, fantastic, supernatural recall of exactly what Jesus said. But if someone talks to you for 3 minutes and your wife says, "What did the person say?" Are you going to give her a 3-minute answer? You're going to shorten it down. You're going to try to get to the core of what that person said. It is all right for scripture writers, when they are saying, "Jesus said this," for them to leave some things out that he said. What would be wrong is if they added things that he didn't say. Or it would be wrong if they gave the wrong impression of what he was trying to convey. So what they say has to be faithful to what he says, but they can leave words out that he said, as long as it doesn't change his meaning. And that's why when you look at the different gospel accounts, you won't see it word for word identical. And then what you also have is some really interesting things where, let's see, I think it's in the case of Jesus speaking with a Samaritan woman. Oh, yes, yes, it is. We can look, I'll translate it from Greek because it's interesting there the way that it's phrased.
Are you going to John?
Yes, John. It's the English translation somewhat covers it up. Yeah, and so when I talk about translating the majority text, that's what I mean. Translating Greek into English.
You're doing it on the spot. It's not in your Bible.
No, this is all in Greek. So let's see. The verse here, let's see. In verse 16, Jesus says to her, "Depart, call your husband, and come here." The woman answered and said, and I'm going to give this very literally, "Not I have husband." So we would translate it, "I do not have a husband." Jesus says to her, "Well, you spoke that husband not I have." So he's quoting her but it's not exactly what she said, but it means what she said. We think of quotes as tape recorder accuracy.
In English.
In English. That wasn't their convention. But it has to be accurate and mean what was said. But it doesn't have to be tape recorder level exactness. But it has to mean what was said. And so a lot of places where people say, well, and run into problems, they didn't have tape recorders. And Jesus is just saying back to her, she'd say, yeah, I said that. And if he were to say, did you say it exactly that way? Well, no, I didn't say it exactly that way. Did you mean what I said? Well, yes. And we get ourselves sometimes into trouble because we don't allow for those types of things to come up. So that's why I translated in Greek. If I had pulled up my English, we translate, I do not have a husband. Rightly, you have said, I do not have a husband. Well, Jesus turned the words around, but he meant exactly what she said. So I mean, there are all sorts of fun things when a person just starts looking at it, and there are all sorts of things that people get all fussed over, and I look at it and I say, okay, well, I think we're probably there. So,
thank you, God. Can you close us in prayer?
Sure. Father, we do thank you for your word, and we thank you that we know that it's true, and we pray that you would cause us to focus on your word, even as circumstances are very difficult. We pray that you would motivate us to be co-heirs by suffering with Christ, and that we would have a willingness to stand up for him based upon us learning to walk by the Spirit and not by the flesh, that our suffering would be converted from penal servitude, a penalty, into something that is rewardable as co-heirs with the firstborn inheritor of all. And I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.